Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sridhar Natarajan. I work for Concurrent Technologies Corporation. And today I want to present some of the research that we've been doing into gesture-based computing and brain-computer interfaced devices, kind of explore the art of the possible in applications in learning and human performance. So I just want to give a shout out to a couple of my colleagues who help pull this thing together. Sean Thropp, he's somewhere around. There he is in the back. And Alan Hoberney, who's back in at our company headquarters in Johnstown. So a little bit about our company. We are a not-for-profit applied research and development company. I like to think of our company as a place where technologies and ideas come together and leading to applications for our clients. We pride ourselves in understanding our clients' needs and work in an unbiased way to find solutions for them. So in this session, I want to, as I said, I want to focus on the art of the possible with two specific technologies. Gesture-based computing interface technologies, which is a fancy word for a product that's out there on the market, the Microsoft Kinect, which ships with the Xbox. Basically what it is it's an instance, it's a commercial instance of a product that can interpret human gestures. Essentially it can map your skeleton and all the degrees of freedom in your body and make it available as a software signal. But we also have the brain-computer interface technology. Specifically, we have done some work with the EPOC neuro headset from a company called Emotive. It picks up 14 channels of EEG signals straight from your brain. And they do have a software development toolkit with which we have managed to integrate a bunch of different systems. So essentially we have integrated the neuro signals to command a humanoid robot, for instance. We have used it to navigate Google Earth. We have used it to fly a little quadricopter drone using your mind. So they're all, I have a few of those demonstrations here, and I'm gonna, after my talk, I'm gonna set them up at 2 o'clock, and you're welcome to stay and even try out this headset. You'd be amazed at how much work your brain is doing as you think about certain things. So I also want to encourage you to participate in some ideation. Bring some ideas forward. Let's work together. Like I said, we are always looking for partners to work with, to take solutions to our clients. How we started was we got a couple of students from local universities. We got some commercial products that were out in the market. Like this headset retails for about $300. You can get it off of eBay, or you can go to the company and buy it. The SDK costs a little bit more money. But the robot, you know, that's any hobby store, you can get a humanoid robot. And we just got some students. We wanted to see how much expertise do you need to put these together. So that was also part of the exercise. What's the human capital required? So we had 4 students, little lab space about the size of this cube, and these kids pulled off a bunch of cool demos in a matter of weeks. So the art of the possible, it's here, and I think it'll only get more and more advanced. The technology gets more and more advanced, and we are always going to be challenged to find the applications for it. Another thing I want to mention is the open source ecosystem that's around these technologies. We wrote very little code. We wrote integration code. There were all kinds of SDKs, open source code that was available. The devices themselves were so mature because they are commercial devices. They didn't break, they were extremely stable, and they were repetitive, so it made lab work pretty easy. It was also intuitive the way these things worked, and maybe it's a generational thing, maybe the kids these days are so savvy with technologies that they can immediately understand how these things work. But I learned I mean, most of the work was being done by the students, but I picked it up within the last month, and it was pretty easy for me too. So we think it's pretty well designed, all these things. So we do think that these technologies and a bunch of newer ones that are on the horizon are going to usher us towards the next generation of learning and human performance systems, and I want to talk a little bit about that. First, I want to kind of show, I know it's hard to read, but this is the latest Gartner Group's hype cycle, and I kind of circled some of the technologies that are already figuring in learning and human performance systems, like speech recognition, even, you know, I got Siri on my iPhone, right? I mean, it recognizes my speech, no problem, no. Doesn't have a problem with my accent, right? So it's pretty advanced. Mobile application stores are pretty mature. I see a lot of mobile content being developed and being advertised in this forum. Virtual worlds, I mean, we know it's coming along, but there are a bunch that are on the left of this curve that we are trying to focus on. There's gesture recognition over there. I mean, it's kind of on the mature slope because of some of the commercial products that are out there. But here's computer brain interface, and they've tagged it as more than 10 years for it to get commercialized. Doesn't mean that in the research space there's not any activity. In fact, there's a lot of research being done on how to use that to in a variety of applications: neuromarketing, education, healthcare, treating people with PTSD, TBI, that kind of stuff. And then this is our chief technical officer's favorite: human augmentation. He believes that we'll all be walking around with implants in about 10 years, and it'll be so natural as carrying one of these iPhones that we won't even mind it. So. Scary stuff, but we think it's going to happen. So, what are we trying to do here? We want to take those technologies and push the whole learning and human performance systems market to a place where it's headed. If you look at this chart, we think the market is somewhere in the higher cost current generation systems, where you pretty much have generalized static content delivery on dated platforms. Of course, there's been some movement towards the next generation, but we think the next generation systems are going to be very personalized, adaptive, immersive, virtual, available anytime, anywhere, and on modern computing platforms. I know mobile is we're kind of cracking the nut on mobile, but you've got the cloud coming up. It's going to change the way we're going to share content and data. And as we see the budget pressures, the market pressures are shifting us more towards lower cost solutions. So that's the end state, and we want to be on the trajectories, the right trajectories, so we can help shape our march onto this end state. So we are looking for specific partnerships. Already the technologies, we are tracking those. And we are doing some offerings out there in our client space, but we want to make it more a spiral in, spin out kind of process, so we're continuously learning, refining, applying, and kind of accelerating our growth and progress. So if you want to stick around, we have a couple of demos we can show you. Sean has a pretty cool demo on training avatars using Kinect. I got the neuro demo for controlling the bioloid robot. I also got a Kinect to control the robot as well. So I invite you to stay back and take a look at some of these demos. So here's the ideation piece of the presentation. What are the potential applications, especially in learning and human performance? Neurofeedback. I mean, there's been research done in all these areas and in multiple universities, but neurofeedback could be practicing your state of mind to be at its most receptive for learning. I think, you know, there is a line of research which says that that's controllable. You could practice getting your mind into that state. There's research getting into adaptive peak performance trainer. You know, you often hear someday an NBA point guard is shooting his lights out. So what does that mean? he's performing at his peak. So how do you get there? So if you use a neuro device, there are ways that, and you can establish your peak performance profile. You can practice getting into that profile before game time, you know. And that could apply not just to athletes. It could be musicians. It could be anybody in a highly skilled position, or just a student. So there's a lot of research being done there. There's the bulk of the market in neuro is in neurostimulation. I'm sure you heard about the cochlear implants that actually hear real speech. They translate it into synthetic speech and directly feed the signal to your brain. So, hearing impaired people can experience hearing for the first time. Similarly, visually impaired people are seeing for the first time. These are all caused, or they are being enabled by neurotechnology. Thought pattern recognition. I mean, we believe that there are ways that you could monitor the state of mind of somebody's. Let's say you're operating a very delicate piece of machinery, and you're not in the cognitive state of mind to perform those delicate operations. If you had a neurosensor that's monitoring you, it could warn you, hey, you may not be in a suitable state of mind to do this at this time. You want to take a break. So that's being done. There's some research being done there. And on the gesture-based side, we've attempted to train avatars. I'm sure you've seen expensive systems and expensive ways to program avatars to do human-like functions. But using a Kinect, you could actually capture human motion very realistically and impose that on an avatar, so the avatar behaves very human-like in terms of its skeletal gestures, not the facial part. I'm not talking about that. But we feel that that'll save. Remember that low cost, shift towards low cost, we think that will be one of the key technology enablers for that. Touch-free interfaces, this is my favorite. If you have seen movies like Minority Report, you got like Tom Cruise, right? Tom Cruise was just manipulating interfaces with gestures and thoughts. I think it's thoughts too. But those kinds of touch-free interfaces are possible, especially if you're operating in sterile environments or hostile environments where you cannot use your hands. So so that's some of the ideas that we want to explore. Obviously, there are going to be a million more. We'd love to hear them from you. And like I said, I'm here. Sean is here rest of the day. Feel free to stop by, look at our demos, talk to us, see how we can help you, or how you can help us, and we can all help our clients. And that's pretty much it. So I just want to thank you for your attention, and I'll be glad to take any questions that you might have.